Don't know me, my name's Levi. Pastor David and Pastor Tina are on holiday at the moment, so I've been given the honor and the privilege of bringing the word to you today. And I just ask that you prepare your hearts, pull out your notebooks, turn with me to Exodus 23 verse 20, and we're going to read from there and just sing out amen when you get there. Amen. So we're starting from verse 20, Exodus 23 verse 20. See, I am sending an angel ahead of you to guard you along the way and to bring you to the place I have prepared. Pay attention to him and listen to what he says. Do not rebel against him. He will not forgive your rebellion, since my name is in him. If you listen carefully to what he says and do all that I say, I will be an enemy to your enemies, and I will oppose those who oppose you. My angel will go ahead of you and bring you into the land of the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, and Jebusites, and I will wipe them out. Do not bow down before their gods or worship them or follow their practices. You must demolish them and break their sacred stones to pieces. Worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be on your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea and from the desert to the Euphrates River. And we stop there. So last week, church, Pastor Tina was talking about breaking camp. And this is the message of this day. It's about breaking camp. It's about being uncomfortable. It's about uprooting things in order to move to the next destination, to move outside of your comfort zones and make those uncomfortable places your comfort place, to follow the pillar of smoke by day and the pillar of fire by night, not to settle and to keep moving, for it's in moving that you find yourself. There will be friction, yes, but this is a good thing. Things are forever changing and ever evolving. So get used to it. And moving, I believe God has a higher level that he wants you and I to get to. And he has already prepared this place for us. In verse 20, God speaks about sending an angel ahead of us to guard us along the way so that we are not alone on this journey. He knows there will be trials and tribulations along the way, but rest assured, you will be comforted in this place, in this space, and in this time. Verse 21 and 22, God says that Moses must listen and obey, which is what the last series has been all about. Hearing God's voice, distinguishing between his voice, our own carnal voice, and the devil's voice, and then being obedient to what God tells us and not doing the opposite, not rebelling. As God then says, he will oppose those who oppose Moses, simply meaning he will bring victory to Moses and he will overcome the enemies. Today, we're actually going to be focusing on verse 23 and 24, where God says to Moses that he will send an angel ahead into the land of the Amorites. One, write this down. Two, the Hittites. Number three, the Perizzites. Four, Canaanites. Five, Hivites. And number six, Jebusites. And he will wipe them out. He then goes on to say that he does not want Moses and his people to bow down before their gods or worship their practices. He's basically saying he wanted Moses to have nothing to do with them and that Moses must demolish them and break their sacred stones to pieces. Otherwise, they will cause Moses and his people to sin against God himself. Now, these people are the people of the day of Moses. They're descendants from Noah through to Ham and Canaan himself. So they're the descendants from the direct line of Noah, and they occupied the land of the day. Obviously, this instruction was a natural instruction in that time for Moses to lead his people to take out all of these nations. All right? But what we're talking about is today. Because today our battle is not against flesh and blood. It's against rulers. It's against authorities. against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. I believe the six nations that God wants us to conquer are purely demonic spirits, and he wants us to uproot and to destroy these so that we can possess his promise for us individually, as a family, and as a church. You see, he has already prepared the way for us. Unfortunately, it's these spirits, strongholds that tie us down and really keep us stuck in a place where breaking camp becomes difficult. And we tend to stray when everyone is traveling on the road to the next destination. This is when we go off track, guys. We start wandering in the wilderness, far from the pillar of smoke, far from the pillar of fire, away from everyone else. We conjure up our own way of thinking, fueled by Satan himself, because these demons have overtaken us. So let us talk about the first demon. The first demon is the Amorite spirit, which is a spirit of negative talk. It's a spirit of gossip. It's a spirit of slander. Amorite comes from the word, the Hebrew word, amar, which is the act of speaking. It's to utter, to say, or to tell. They call the Amorites the talkers. So the Amorite spirit is a demonic spirit that entraps Christians with deviant words of slander towards ourselves and towards one another. I'm talking about Christians that gossip about others covertly and even overtly in front of their faces. It's about people who exaggerate the truth. It's about people who are talking negative all the time. It's about people who engage in coarse jokes, people who slander, people who lie, people who argue, people who swear, and people who just simply moan and groan. I'm talking about degrading yourselves. I'm talking about degrading others, condemning others, teasing others, all kinds of talk that's plain right down and nasty. Amen? You hear what I'm saying? Some examples of this. Start talking about girls. Don't hit me, girls. I see this happening sometimes, eh? Girls talk about other girls. Guys, we don't talk about guys. You know, guys, yeah, that's cool, whatever. Leave him to do his thing. Girls, another hand. That girl there, she's so pretty, but she ain't got no brain. It's that sort of stuff we're talking about. It's the ones where you're talking about, you know, girls are doing stuff. Oh, she's fat. She's this, she's that. Husband and wives arguing about the pettiest of things. I mean, I can testify to this. Me and Jess, just last night even, we had an argument. We actually can't even remember what we're talking about, to be honest. You know, we were going along, yelling at each other, doing this, doing that. And I can tell you, when it gets to the end of it, we look back and we go, what were we talking about? Where did that start? You never can. We never know why. We never know what it's about, because it's so small and insignificant that we shouldn't even have gone there. Husbands lying about where you've been for the past 2 hours, coming home late from work. Your wife's asking you where you've been and you say you've been working late. You haven't been working late. You've been down the road with your mates or doing something else. Whatever it is, you haven't been at work. Number four, you know, it's like swearing in the workplace. You got guys at work, they're swearing away. You just happen to get caught up in it. Next minute, you know, you're swearing, you're saying the exact same things that they're doing. This is what we're talking about. This is the Amorite spirit at work, guys. In James 3, verse 5, it says, likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. And in Proverbs 18:21, it says the tongue has the power of life and of death, and those that love it will eat its fruit. You see, as our sword is God's word, words are also the enemy's. And he knows how to twist, he knows how to manipulate, and he knows how to take advantage in order to oppress God's children and the church. God wants to absolutely annihilate this type of thinking and doing from this church so that we can collectively reach the promised land. Amen? It's going to be uncomfortable, church, but you need to force yourself to be better. You need to allow the Amorite spirit. You can't allow the Amorite spirit to consume you, to envelop you, and to take over your life. And I declare from this day on, From this moment, the Spirit is no longer welcome in this church or in this city or in this nation, and it has no home in God's house. Be wary, church, and hold each other accountable to the discussions you have with your fellow brothers and sisters. Keep it holy. And if you sense the Amorite spirit creeping in, smash it and get rid of it before it rears itself. We need to get to a place where all we talk about is building ourselves up and building others up and empowering each other so that we can move forward and we can rise up, church. For Ephesians 4:29 states, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen." That's the Amorite spirit. Number two, we're talking about the Hittite spirit. Say Hittite. The spirit of fear and terror. Hittite means hatat in Hebrew, which is terror or depleting of strength or to be broken. The Hittite spirit is a debilitating spirit that wants to consume you also from the inside out. It's a spirit of fear and terror, and it's a very spirit that the likes of ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and Hamas are using to isolate and break down society and followers of Christ. It's a spirit that attacks you and will manifest as depression, suicidal thoughts, phobias, and all kinds of anxiety. The spirit takes over your emotions, central nervous system, until you have little control of how you respond and act. You may experience deep emotional despair and psychological torment. This despair could lead you into depression, isolation, and even suicide. The same spirit controls terrorists, as I just said, that are prepared to commit suicide in the name of Allah. I'm telling you, it's a Hittite spirit at the helm here, totally dominating the mind and the thinking of such organizations. And it's this spirit that we absolutely need to smash also. But just like every other spirit, it's the same. God's word is the sword that will slay it. God's word is the sword that will slay the Hittite spirit and smash it into smithereens. God's word is what will make the spirit flee with every utterance of truth that resonates from your mouth. The heart condition will also drive the spirit out. For out of you, it begins with love. Because 1 John 4:28 states, "There is no fear in love." Because perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is made perfect in love. So learn to love yourself, learn to love others, and this fear will indefinitely leave you. Anxiety, self-doubt, negative views of this world will subside. Lean on the authority of Jesus and find strength in him to bring light into this darkness and get rid of it. It's exactly what they're trying to do today, church. And I'm not sure if you've been watching the news, but there's so much going on overseas. And what they're trying to do is instill fear into you guys, instill fear into our nation. But we won't let that happen, guys. As a church, we need to rise, we need to stand together, and we need to get rid of that spirit of fear. We need to continue doing our daily chores. We need to continue with each day. Don't hide from it. Get out and show them that you are not fearful of them, because that is what is needed for the movement of Christ to continue advancing in this time, in this day. Amen? Number three, the parasite spirit, the spirit of separation. Parasite means the city or village with no walls. The parasite spirit is a division in the church where the body of Christ is only partially functioning because certain individuals have let down their guard and have allowed the enemy to enter through the side gates. The parasite spirit tries to feed your flesh, to break down your spiritual wars so the enemy can take over and deceive you into feeling a false sense of security in your needs, wants, and desires, so that you take your eyes off what God has called you to do in your life. like a city whose walls are broken through as a person who lacks self-control. Proverbs 25:28. It is a spirit of procrastination and anger. And the more you give into this spirit, the more you find yourself doing the opposite of what God wants you to do and what he wants others to do. It's the voice that tells you, she'll be right, mate. Or it's the voice that tells you to hop out of the car and punch that person that just beeped at you for being too slow. It's the voice that says, I'm going to send off a nasty message because I don't like what that person said to me on Facebook. It's the voice that says that someone's just it's the voice that tells you to stir the pot when the pot just shouldn't be stirred. It's the voice and the spirit that gets you to collude with others and create alliances for one yourself in order to get others to believe that you are right and the other person is wrong. It's the spirit that says don't support that ministry because you don't feel that it is of God. It's the parasite spirit that has you talking about the leaders of this church and how they should be doing this or should be doing that. The parasite spirit's main aim is to conquer and divide the church. It's a spirit that understands the power, that power is unstoppable, is the unstoppable, that we have the power and we have an unstoppable force when we unite. And I believe God wants to destroy this division in the church and bring true unity, not just to a surface level unity where we're up front saying, yeah, I support you in this, but behind closed doors, you're saying, no, I don't want to do that. That shouldn't be done. It's the voice that says, this is how we should be, church. We should be united, wholehearted, together as one, going through life, going through our circumstances, trials and tribulations, together as one, united. Amen? It's this spirit that we need to come together for and get rid of it, guys. Get rid of it. It's not welcome here. And if you have issues with that, I pray for you right now to bring it to the surface and get rid of it. Submit to the leaders, to submit to the church, submit to the vision, and most importantly, submit to our God, because he is the one that wants you to change. He is the one that wants you to unite and be behind everyone that's doing great things in this church. Amen? What are we up to? Number four. The Canaanite spirit. This is a spirit of control. Canaanites means kana, which is to be subdued. So the Canaanite spirit is one of control and domination. And it's a spirit that suffocates the Holy Spirit himself and does not enable things to flow in God's timing and order. The Canaanite spirit can be seen in the form of OCD. Obsessive compulsive disorder. Come on, ladies. You know what you're talking about here. Amen. Amen. Amen, eh, guys? Or leaders that have to have everything done their way or the highway, that leave little room for others to contribute and find themselves in things that they are good at, that leave little room for strengths to flourish, for people to rise up because they're so worried about keeping things under control and not having faith in our fellow Christians and our fellow brothers and sisters to do what they're good at. The Canaanite spirit takes over and as it is inflexible, it finds it difficult to adapt and makes you react negatively when change occurs. The Canaanite spirit keeps you in the tent when everyone else is moving and packing up to move on. In the old environment, you were in control. Yet this new destination is uncertain and unpredictable, and you don't like it because you no longer have control of the situation. Amen? The Canaanite spirit can be seen in marriages where the husband or wife tries to control every movement of one another. They try to control how you spend time, who you spend time with. They try to make you feel guilty about what you're doing with your time. Amen. I see a few people laughing. The Canaanite spirit is exactly that. It's a spirit of control. in the same spirit has no place in this church, guys. It has no place in where we're going. If we want to move camp, we need to get rid of this. Because if we're holding on to what's behind us, how can we move forward? Amen? We need to let go and move forward. We need to stop looking behind us and move forward and go where we need to go. And we need to go together, united as one. Amen? Number five, the Hivite spirit. The Hivite spirit is a spirit of material lust. Hivites means hawa, which means to collect or gather. There was a few sighs there. Let me tell you, this spirit has consumed me and still does to this day. I must admit, it's still there. And there's sometimes I let it go, but it slowly sneaks its way back in. And I don't even know it's there until it's too late. And next minute I'm thinking, oh no, where am I going? Where am I going? And I need to get rid of that. So if there's anyone out there that has the same spirit, the Canaanite spirit is a spirit that seduces you into thinking that material things, money, and so forth is going to solve your problems. That nice things, flash cars, big homes, 60-inch flat screen TV, and the likes are going to answer all of your problems. You're fooling yourself, church, if you think that's the case. The Canaanite spirit has often been the cause of wars, where countries seek to advance their territories in lieu of great wealth. Because Jesus warns us in Mark 14, where he talks about the parable of the sower. And in particularly where still others like seeds, this is it, still others like seeds sown among thorns hear the word, but the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires of other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. It's a spirit that caused Saul to lose his kingdom, Achan to lose his life and his wife and his children. It's a spirit that caused Judas to betray Jesus for a mere 30 pieces of silver. For Lot and Abraham's feuding, the hook that Satan used when trying to tempt Jesus, when he said, I will give you all the knowledge and the wealth of this world if you just follow me. The devil led him up to a high place, and that's what he showed him. You see, Jesus was able to, he was strong enough to not be tempted by that. But unfortunately, we are mere humans. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And unfortunately for me, this is my biggest stronghold. It's a stronghold of material wealth that has nothing in this life. It has no lasting value. And it's not even going to go where you're going to go when you go to heaven with your Lord and Savior. It's going to stay here and it's going to fall to pieces. Amen? This is a spirit that gets you to love money more than God. And it's the cause of most people's backsliding. It's a cause of why Christians turn their back on their faith, because they're so busy chasing money that they forget about God himself. The Bible said the love of money is the root of all evil. And you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve money and God. You either need to go for God or go for money. Money will cause you to sin, and in sin is death. In Jesus Christ, there is everlasting life. Choose that way every time, church. Amen? Who here has a Hivite spirit? Just me? Okay, that's all good. It's all good. Just me up here. I'm preaching to myself here. Number six, the final spirit we're talking about. There's actually seven spirits, but I'm only going to do six spirits today. You can see the seventh spirit in Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 7, where it talks about the Girgashites, which is the Girgashite spirit. But we won't talk about that today. The Jebusite spirit is a spirit of guilt and condemnation. For Jebusite comes from the Hebrew word bas, which means treading down or trodden on. And it's a spirit that causes you to be guilty. The Jebusite spirit is one that makes you feel guilty and shame and leads you into deception that you're no good and that you are a failure. The spirit will also lie to you about your place in God's kingdom and tell you that you are not loved because you are wicked and because you are a sinner. The spirit will highlight your faults and bring it out into the open because it knows that you will feel guilty about these things and you'll take it personally. The Spirit will put up a barrier between yourself and Jesus and make you forget that Jesus sacrificed himself for you, and that his sacrifice meant nothing, and because you're sinning, you won't be accepted by him. The Spirit will make you think that the only way to heaven is to work harder, to do more, and to please God through your works, because you're trying to cover up your sins and your acts. You think that you need to go and go into this ministry and do that, or go into that ministry and do that, and all you're doing is going from one to the other without making any real movement or any real contribution, because you think it's the more that you do, the closer you're going to be to him. Church, I'm telling you, that is not how it works. God's grace and mercy is for all of you. It is not by works that you're going to get his grace. Amen? You'll forever be trying to please others, and often you will personalize things that go on. When you hear people talking over here and you hear your name in the conversation, you think they're saying something nasty about you. But what you don't realize, they're actually praising you. That's what you'll think. You'll think that everything that's going on in your life, any problems or any issues, is because of you. You take it personally. You think that everything that goes on at work, why am I not getting this? Why am I not getting that? Because of you. You'll personalize things. And you'll personalize things to a level that will cause you to go into that depression also. And that's when the other spirit will come and take over you and say, hey, there's my man. They're ready. I want to jump into him or her. Romans 8:1 says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So the six spirits, church, we need to get rid of them. Do not bow down before their gods or worship them or follow their practices. You must demolish them and break their sacred stones to pieces. Worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be on your food and water. He will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. He will give you a full lifespan. He will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea and from the desert to the Euphrates River. Breaking camp, church, is purely about lording it over these spirits and ridding them from ourselves, from our church, from this nation, and from the kingdom of God. We're breaking camp, church, and we're moving forward, and there's absolutely no place for these spirits. There's absolutely no place for these spirits. And if you find yourself with one of these spirits, go to the Word. Go to his Word, because that is our sword. That is your sword, and the sword will slay any spirit that comes near you. But it takes self-awareness. You need to be aware of when the spirit starts to arise. You need to be aware when that anger starts to arise, just like mine. You need to be aware of that. I wasn't aware. And sometimes I'm still not aware. And I just believe that if we put this out in the open and we talk about it, that's the start. That's a start where we can start saying, you know what? Let's be honest with ourselves. Let's be honest with what spirit is inside of us so that we can deal with it, because we want to move camp. We want to move on, church. We want to break camp and we want to take it to the next level. We don't want you guys to be left behind. We don't want you to start walking, or we start walking down the road and next minute you go off track. And you're in the bushes somewhere. You're in the bushes and you can't even find your way. There's no food, there's no water down over there, because you're in the higher place, and you need to be in the valley where we are, where the water is, where you can be fed. That's where you need to be, church. Get rid of those spirits. And I just urge you and I encourage you to bind together and talk about these spirits. Talk about them openly and honestly so that we can deal to them and we can get rid of them once and for good. Amen. Say bless, yeah.